Good morning, beloveds. Brain. I don't even. I got two of my coworkers on vacation this week, and so literally there were just two of us in the store yesterday. Now, yes, Betsy was there, but all Betsy can do is talk to customers. She can't read bottles. She can't find bottles because she can't read bottles. She can't hear, so she can't answer the phone. So it was just like there were two of us doing everything. And now do not let me discount the value of her being there and talking to customers, but it was just like my br I'm just by the end of this week, I'm gonna need a week's vacation from my coworker's vacation. And it's only because there are two of them gone. If it was just one, it wouldn't be so bad. But no, there's two. All right. What just happened back there? All right. So it is March 3rd. Our title is "I Am Held in the Goodness of God." The quote is, "And God, even our spirit, which hath loved us, comfort your heart and establish you in every good word and work." And that is 2 Thessalonians 2, 16 and 17. Okay. If we assume an all-powerful or infinite presence and power back of, within, and through everything, as we must, then we should realize that this power or presence, which is God, could not possibly operate against itself without destroying itself. We know of no energy in nature that can destroy itself. This means that the power back of everything actually is good, or as Jesus said, there is none good save one, which is God. We need not worry about this or wonder about it or ask questions about it. It is self-evident that goodness alone can endure forever. Good is a synonym for God. Good and God mean the same thing. Therefore, the final truth and absolute reality about all things is that God is good. And since God is the divine presence right where we are, good is right where we are and ever available to us. But we must recognize and claim this good if we are to use it. Today, I know that my good is at hand. I see this good in person and places and things. Nothing but goodness can go from me. Nothing but goodness can return to me. There is nothing unlike goodness in my experience. There is nothing but kindness, nothing but generosity. My whole inner being responds to this goodness, recognizes it everywhere. Feeling it in everything, seeing it everywhere, I am enveloped in it. Even as I draw this goodness to me and become saturated with it, it flows out in every direction, blessing everything. Pardon me. Oh. Okay, blessing everything it touches, helping everyone, bringing wholeness and happiness to everyone. God's goodness endureth forever, and I endure forever. In joy, then, I awake to every new day. In joy, I rest in the eternal goodness, and evermore there is a song in my heart as it overflows with the acknowledgement of good. And that is spring. This sounds like classic Emma. It sounds like classic Emma. And I need to reboot my computer, which is neither here nor there. But when I know that it's time to reboot my computer is when I'm trying to share posts and Facebook's like, no. So I'm like, okay, then clearly I just need to turn my computer all the way off. Which means I need to read the articles and close those tabs. And I saw one this morning and it was talking about the brain rewiring itself. The brain is an amazing organ, And it is an organ. Don't let anybody convince you that it is, it's not an organ. It is absolutely an organ. And it is constantly wiring itself. You are constantly making new connections. That is the benefit of going out and doing new things, learning new skills, is because it causes your brain to create new dendrites and new neurons and, new parts of your brain. It causes your brain to create new parts. And what the point of this meme that I saw on Facebook was, which I, if I see it again, I'll grab it, but it is what it is. is that if you are constantly complaining, then your brain will wire itself to find things for you to complain about. So if you want to have a good, happy, celebrate, then that's what you want to look for. Because whatever it is that you look for, whatever it is that you are doing, then that is what your brain is going to wire itself to do. You literally make, and we can use the positive term grooves, or we can use the negative term ruts. Okay. You can make positive grooves in your brain so that your brain's like, oh, I like this. We're gonna do this. Or are you in a rut? Are you constantly looking for things to complain about? Because then your brain's going, oh, well, this is what you like to do. Well, then let me just make it easier for you to do. All right. So it's like if you find yourself constantly complaining all the time, it's a habit you want to break because you want to rewire your brain. And how do you rewire your brain? By doing something else. It's like that's why I said with habits. We don't actually break habits. What we do is we create new ones to replace the ones that we don't want anymore. And that's the way it works. That's literally the way your brain works. It's like whatever you are consistently feeding your brain will find and show you more of. So if you are constantly seeing problems and you're constantly looking for problems, your brain goes, oh, this is what you want. Let me show you more. All right. So if you're constantly looking for solutions, then your brain goes, oh, this is what you want. Let me do that. So it's like take a page out of Emma's book, even though this is Raymond and Ernest, of look for the good and praise it. Because the more you look, the more you see. Because your brain literally goes, oh, this is what we want. All right, let's do this. And the law is the same way. The law is the same way. It's like the law does not judge. Whatever you put into the law is what the law is going to give back to you. Do you want good or do you want, reasons to complain? So, what Ernest is saying, he's kind of given you this mathematical proof today. It's like, God's good. Here's why. I am held in the goodness of God. Take the Bible quote for what it is. It's 2 Thessalonians 2, chapter 2, lines 16 and 17. And God, even our spirit, which hath loved us, comfort your hearts and establish you in every good word and work. Go read it. I don't know what to do with it. So here's his mathematical style proof, his logical argument. If we assume an all-powerful or infinite presence and power back up within and through everything, as we must, basis of science of mine here, then we should realize that this power or presence, which is God, could not possibly operate against itself without destroying itself. All right. And then his second line is, because that was all one sentence, by the way, we know of no energy in nature which can destroy itself. And that is basic thermodynamics. There's three laws of thermodynamics, and one of them is energy can neither be created nor destroyed. It can be changed, but it can't be created or destroyed. So that's what Ernest is saying here. We know that no energy in nature can destroy itself. This means that the power back of everything actually is good, or as Jesus said, there is none good save one, which is God. All right. And we all come from that one, which means we are all good. Now, the applications we make of this, that's where we can get ourselves in trouble. We need not worry about this or wonder about it or ask questions about it. It is self-evident that goodness alone can endure forever because God is good. Good is a synonym for God. Good and God mean the same thing. Therefore, the final truth and absolute reality about all things is that God is good. All right? And since God is the divine presence right where we are, good is right where we are and ever available to us. And that's why I say, if you walk into a messy situation, you want to look for the good. There will always be good in a messy situation because you will bring it with you. You will bring it with you. Absolutely, you will bring it with you. And then, if there are other people involved in the situation, as you walk in, then your good can spark up their good. It can bring out their good because they've got it. They've got it. And if you walk into the situation, then your good is going to attract theirs. All right. Now, that's not a call to put yourself in harmful situations just because, you know, but if you walk into a situation, then Emma would tell you, if you walk into the situation, then there's something that you can do. Okay. Now, Emma said, if you walk into it. Emma did not say, well, just walk into any situation because there's something you can do. Because sometimes it's not your work to do. All right? Just remember that. But know that if you walk into the situation, you're bringing the good with you. But we must recognize it and claim this good if we are to use it. All right? If you hear the mission today. Today, I know that my good is at hand. I see this good in persons and places and things because I'm going to look for the God. I'm going to look for the God in everything. Nothing but goodness can go from me and nothing but goodness can return to me. That's a power statement. You want to set your day up right? There you go. And he starts it out by saying nothing but good can come from me. And if nothing but good is coming from me, then that is what is going to be. What I put out is what I get back. So the more good I do, the more good I will get back. There is nothing unlike good in my experience. There is nothing but kindness, nothing but generosity. My whole inner being responds to this goodness, recognizes it everywhere. Feeling it everywhere, seeing it everywhere. I am enveloped in it. And that's the goal. It's like, let's look around at this world and see all of the good. Because the more good we see, the more good we can do. And things that aren't quite there, we can right that. But we have to start with the good. We have to start with the good. We have to recognize that there is, we have to recognize the possibility. And starting with the good is how we recognize the possibility. Because, I mean, we've all had those situations where we walk in and we go, oh my God, now what? What do I do? Well, the first thing you have to do is find the step, the good. And then that'll let you climb out of it. And the good news is you always carry the goodness inside. Always, 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 always. All right. Even as I draw this goodness to me and become saturated with it, it flows out in every direction, blessing everything it touches, helping everyone, bringing wholeness and happiness to everyone. Okay, so I am saturated with it. But what I have to remember is I am not a container. I am a channel. All right. I am not a container for this good. I am a channel for this good. I am the way. You are the way that goodness moves into the material world. You are not a container. You are a channel and you cannot be broken. All right. Because it flows through you. It flows through you. So don't try and contain it because that's not your job. Your job is channel. Bring it through you into the world so that the goodness in you blesses and touches everything around you. Everything around you. God's goodness endureth forever. It's a quote from somewhere because it's in quotes. And I endure forever because I endure in God, as do you. Enjoy then, I awake to every new day. Enjoy, I rest in the eternal goodness. And evermore, there is a song in my heart as it overflows with the acknowledgement of good. So, the mission today, should we choose to accept it, is to recognize this goodness and claim it to use it. All right. It's about recognizing who we are, recognizing what we were made for, to be that channel of goodness, to be that channel, because we are literally how God enters the material world. Literally. You know, when you go look in the eyes of other beings and you look in your own eyes, that is God looking back at you. That is God looking back at you. All right. You are the good. Absolutely, you are the good. And you are the good because you are a beloved child of God. Always. All right. So I am, that's the mission. Recognize it and claim it. Recognize and claim it and use it and use it. Recognize it, claim it, and use it. The good. The other one, the other spiritual practice that I recommend every day is to do something loving for yourself, do something kind for yourself, do something compassionate for yourself, whatever it looks like. Be it a big thing, be it a small thing, it does not matter. The point is that you are making the effort to do that loving, kind, compassionate thing for yourself because you deserve your own love, your own kindness, your own compassion, and because you are creating that groove that I was talking about, that groove in your brain where you look for the good, you look for the kindness, you look for the compassion, because the more you look, the more you see, the more there is. Thank you, Emma. All right. You are creating a habit, a default setting, a first response. All right. Of love, of kindness, of compassion. If you can do it for yourself, you can do it for anybody. Strangers are e easy. People that we love. Most of the time are easy. Sometimes people that we love are not easy. That's why we practice on ourselves. Because if we can do it for ourselves, then we can do it for anybody in any situation. And it's important to be able to do it for ourselves because things happen. And when they happen, you have a loving, kind, compassionate response. You are in the first step to claiming your good. All right. So, please practice. Three deep breaths, go for a walk, take a nap, drink a cup of coffee, savor a cup of coffee. I don't mean slam a cup of coffee. I mean take the time, drink it, enjoy it, engage all of your senses in it. All right? That's the loving, kind, and compassionate thing I'm talking about. You start with one. And when you start with one and consistently do that, it'll leak. And then you'll find that most of your responses will be that. All right? So, I also encourage you to do something to engage your mind and your body. I encourage you to go get a face full of bright light in the morning. It was really cloudy this morning, wasn't a whole lot of sun. Clouds were interesting, so, you know, early morning. Drink plenty of water. Open the windows of your soul. Allow the breath of heaven to remind you, you do live in heaven right here, right now. It's all around us all the time. It is up to us to see it. Hence opening those windows. Opening those windows. Whatever that means to you. I know I say it because I got it from Ernest, but I'm like, what does it actually mean to you to open the windows of your soul? Sometimes it's simply opening your eyes and seeing the good. Sometimes it's a little more than that. Okay, beloveds. I think it's Thursday. Yeah, it's Thursday. There is a new class starting, and I'm not sure if it's this Thursday or next Thursday, but email info at creativelife.org. It's the power of decision making. And it's taught by practitioner Shirley, and it is fantastic. So she is fantastic. And apparently she didn't like the original class, so she rewrote it. So it'll be amazing. So if you're interested in that, get on that Constant Contact, and then you can get the links that you need to do that. And Reverend David should be on around 5 p.m. with you. I'll be back with you at 9 a.m. And I'm gonna get off before I start sneezing. So I'm gonna tell you to have a great day, an amazing day, a wondrous day, an enchanting day, a magical day, a productive day, a restful day, whatever kind of day you need to have. Because if you need to get stuff done, great. But if you need to rest, that's the kind of day. Have a good day. And if that is too much pressure, simply have a day. Because you are enough just as you are. All right, beloveds. So, catch us on the social medias. You know who we are. We are Creative Life Spiritual Center or Creative Life Spark. I am the running Rev Ryan. If you want to see, that's where these are archived. So if you're watching these and go to the Creative Life, they're not there. I didn't want to get too much on that page. So that's on the Creative Life, is on the Running Rev Ryan YouTube channel. So yeah, there's a lot on there because I do this every day. And I've ordered my next book. Which is out of print. So when I get it, I will show it to you and then we'll get prepared. In this case, I will be reading multiple different writers. It'll be more like what David does with the daily readings, where it's going to be different people. And these are people that Jesse, that taught Jesse. So that'll be really exciting for us to get to know a little bit about how he was taught and who taught him. And it'll be a stretch for me because it won't be Ernest Holmes. It'll be other people talking about Ernest Holmes' works. So, all right, beloveds, know that you're loved. Know that I will see you tomorrow and have a great day. Know that you're loved.